If he learns this little trick, he can become a dispatcher for someone to deliver documents or carry circulars. He'll be able to make a living anywhere. The sky now began to darken, and the master went back to the cave dwelling with his pupils. Throughout the night, however, Wukong practiced ardently and mastered the technique of cloud somersault. From then on, he had complete freedom, blissfully enjoying his state of long life. One day early in the summer, the disciples were gathered under the pine trees for fellowship and discussion. They said to him, "Wukong, what sort of merit did you accumulate in another incarnation that led the master to whisper in your ear the other day the method of avoiding the three calamities? Have you learned everything? I won't conceal this from my various elder brothers." Wukong said, laughing, "Owing to the master's instruction in the first place and my diligence day and night in the second, I have fully mastered the several matters. Let's take advantage of the moment." One of the pupils said, "You try to put on a performance and we'll watch." When Wukong heard this, his spirit was aroused and he was most eager to display his powers. "I invite the various elder brothers to give me a subject," he said. "What do you want me to change into?" "Why not a pine tree?" they said. Wukong made the magic sign and recited the spell. With one shake of his body, he changed himself into a pine tree. Truly it was thickly held in smoke through all four seasons. Its chaste fair form soars straight to the clouds, with not the least likeness to the impish monkey. It's all frost-tried and snow-tested branches. When the multitude saw this, they clapped their hands and roared with laughter, everyone crying, "Marvelous monkey! Marvelous monkey!" They did not realize that all this uproar had disturbed the patriarch, who came running out of the door, dragging his staff. "Who is creating this bedlam here?" he demanded. At his voice, the pupils immediately collected themselves, set their clothes in order, and came forward. Wukong also changed back into his true form, and, slipping into the crowd, he said, "For your information, Reverend Master, we are having fellowship and discussion here. There is no one from outside causing any disturbance. You were all yelling and screaming," said the patriarch angrily, "and were behaving in a manner totally unbecoming to those practicing cultivation. Don't you know that those in the cultivation of Tao resist opening their mouths lest they waste their breath and spirit, or moving their tongues lest they provoke arguments? Why are you all laughing noisily here? We dare not conceal this from the master," the crowd said. "Just now we were having fun with Wukong, who was giving us a performance of transformation. We told him to change into a pine tree, and he did indeed become a pine tree. Your pupils were all applauding him, and our voices disturbed the reverend teacher. We beg his forgiveness." "Go away, all of you," the patriarch said. "You, Wukong, come over here. I ask you, what sort of exhibition were you putting on, changing into a pine tree? This ability you now possess, is it just for showing off to people? Suppose you saw someone with this ability. Wouldn't you ask him at once how he acquired it? So when others see that you are in possession of it, they'll come begging. If you're afraid to refuse them, you will give away the secret. If you don't, they may hurt you. You are actually placing your life in grave jeopardy. I beseech the master to forgive me," Wukong said, kowtowing. "I won't condemn you," said the patriarch, "but you must leave this place." When Wukong heard this, tears fell from his eyes. "Where am I to go, teacher?" he asked. "From wherever you came," the patriarch said. "You should go back there. I came from the East Purvavidiha continent," Wukong said, his memory jolted by the patriarch. "From the water curtain cave of the flower fruit mountain in the Aulai country. Go back there quickly and save your life," the patriarch said. "You cannot possibly remain here. Allow me to inform my esteemed teacher," said Wukong, properly penitent. "I have been away from home for 20 years, and I certainly long to see my subjects and followers of bygone days again. but I keep thinking that my master's profound kindness to me has not yet been repaid. I, therefore, dare not leave. There's nothing to be repaid," said the patriarch. "See that you don't get into trouble and involve me, that's all I ask." Seeing that there was no other alternative, Wukong had to bow to the patriarch and take leave of the congregation. "Once you leave," the patriarch said, "you're bound to end up evil doing. I don't care what kind of villainy and violence you engage in, but I forbid you ever to mention that you are my disciple. For if you but utter half the word, I'll know about it. You can be assured, wretched monkey, that you'll be skinned alive. I will break all your bones and banish your soul to the place of ninefold darkness, from which you will not be released even after 10,000 afflictions. I will never dare mention my master," said Wukong. "I'll say that I've learned this all by myself." Having thanked the patriarch, Wukong turned away, made the magic sign, pulled himself up, and performed the cloud somersault. He headed straight toward the east perv of Adiha, and in less than an hour he could already see the flower fruit mountain and the water curtain cave. Rejoicing secretly, the handsome monkey king said to himself, "I left weighed down by bones of mortal stock. The Tao attained makes light both body and frame. Tease this world's pity that none firmly resolves. To learn such mystery that by itself is plain. 'Twas hard to cross the seas in former time. Returning this day, I travel with ease. Words of farewell still echo in my ears. I ne'er hope to see so soon the eastern depths." Wukong lowered the direction of his cloud and landed squarely on the flower fruit mountain. He was trying to find his way when he heard the call of cranes and the cry of monkeys. The call of cranes reverberated in the heavens, and the cry of monkeys moved his spirit with sadness. "Little ones," he called out, "I have returned. From the crannies of the cliff, from the flowers and bushes, and from the woods and trees, monkeys great and small leapt out by the tens of thousands and surrounded the handsome monkey king. They all kowtowed and cried, 'Great king, what laxity of mind! Why did you go away for such a long time and leave us here longing for your return like someone hungering and thirsting? Recently, we have been brutally abused by a monster who wanted to rob us of our water curtain cave. Out of sheer desperation, we fought hard with him. And yet all this time, that fellow has plundered many of our possessions, kidnapped a number of our young ones, and given us many restless days and nights watching over our property. How fortunate that our great king has returned. If the great king had stayed away another year or so, we and the entire mountain cave would have belonged to someone else." Hearing this, Wukong was filled with anger. "What sort of a monster is this?" he cried. "That behaves in such a lawless manner. Tell me in detail and I will find him to exact vengeance. Be informed, great king," the monkeys said, kowtowing, "that the fellow calls himself the monstrous king of havoc, and he lives north of here." Wukong asked, "From here to his place, how great is the distance?" The monkeys replied, "He comes like the cloud and leaves like the mist, like the wind and the rain, like lightning and thunder. We don't know how great the distance is." "In that case," said Wukong, "go and play for a while and don't be afraid. Let me go and find him." "Dear Monkey King." He leapt up with a bound and somersaulted all the way northward until he saw a tall and rugged mountain. What a mountain! Its pen-like peak stands erect. Its winding streams flow unfathomed and deep. Its pen-like peak, standing erect, cuts through the air. Its winding streams, unfathomed and deep, reach diverse sites on earth. On two ridges flowers rival trees in exotic charm. At various spots pines match bamboos in green. The dragon on the left seems docile and tame. The tiger on the right seems gentle and meek. Iron oxen on occasion are seen plowing. Gold coin flowers are frequently planted. Rare fowls make melodious songs. The phoenix stands facing the sun. Rocks worn smooth and shiny. by water placid and bright. Appear by turns grotesque, bizarre, and fierce. In countless numbers are the world's famous mountains, where flowers bloom and wither. They flourish and die. What place resembles this long-lasting scene? Wholly untouched by the four seasons and eight epochs. This is, in the three regions, the Mount of Northern Spring. The water belly cave, nourished by the five phases. The handsome Monkey King was silently viewing the scenery when he heard someone speaking. He went down the mountain to find who it was, and he discovered the water belly cave at the foot of a steep cliff. Several imps who were dancing in front of the cave saw Wukong and began to run away. "Stop!" cried Wukong. "You can use the words of your mouth to communicate the thoughts of my mind. I am the lord of the water curtain cave in the flower fruit mountain south of here. Your monstrous king of havoc, or whatever he's called, has repeatedly bullied my young ones, and I have found my way here with the specific purpose of settling matters with him." Hearing this, the imps darted into the cave and cried out, "Great king, a disastrous thing has happened." "What sort of disaster?" asked the monstrous king. "Outside the cave," said the imps, "there is a monkey who calls himself the lord of the water curtain cave in the flower fruit mountain. He says that you have repeatedly bullied his young ones, and that he has come to settle matters with you." Laughing, the monstrous king said, "I have often heard those monkeys say that they have a great king, who has left the family to practice self-cultivation. He must have come back.